Thank you, Junior, Ron, James, Calvin. Appreciate that so much. At my father's. So thank you, Bibles. Let's turn together to the Gospel of John. John chapter 1. This morning we're going to begin a brand new series. Happy New Year, everybody. It's a new year. We got some new things to talk about. We just got through celebrating the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And when you stop and you realize, you go back to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you see them portraying Jesus as a little child, and you see the birth of Christ. And that's what we just celebrated. But John's gospel takes a different approach. John's gospel sees the coming of Christ as something spectacular. He sees it as the coming of grace. It is so important for us to understand. We throw the concept, the idea of grace around a lot in the church. We say, well, you know, we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, but we really don't have an understanding of what the grace of God is all about. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a Welsh minister from the late 1800s, he once said that the true measure of spirituality is how amazed we are at the grace of God. Stop and think about that for just a minute. My fear is that I'm not nearly amazed enough by what God has done for me through Jesus Christ. My fear is that I still think that there's something good enough in me that I can contribute to what Jesus has already accomplished on the cross. And anytime it starts being about me and ceases to be about Him, I have moved away from the grace of God. This morning, we need a grace breakthrough. If you ever look at other people and try to judge them based on their behavior, you need a grace breakthrough. If you've ever walked through the Christian life and you've wondered, does God really love me? I'm here to tell you, you need a grace breakthrough. If you've ever wondered about where God is in this moment, because sometimes circumstances get tough. If you've ever wondered, where is God in this, you need a grace breakthrough. This morning, I want you to know, we're going to begin a brand new series today. We're going to start by laying some foundation work, trying to figure out who exactly needs a grace breakthrough. And then we're going to begin to build on that week after week after week until we experience the fullness of God's grace, that we experience and live in a grace breakthrough. Repeat this after me. I need a grace breakthrough. Now, some of you are going to be sitting back and you're going to say, well, you know what? I know some people that need to hear this sermon, but certainly not me. I'm here to tell you, if that's your attitude, you need a grace breakthrough. John chapter 1. We're going to go back and pick it up in verse 14. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Get your outlines out. We'll be working on them together as we think together about the grace breakthrough. Listen to what it says, beginning in verse 14. I'm reading out of the New King James Version. And the Word became flesh, the Word talking about Jesus, became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of Him and cried out, saying, this was He of whom I said, He who comes after me is preferred before me, for He was before me. And of His fullness we have all received grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. When John writes for us, he tells us that at the coming of Christ, grace appeared. Grace came in the birth, the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus. That was the encapsulation of God's grace. That was the grace of God appearing. That was the grace breakthrough. Before that time, John is clear. He says Moses came and God gave the law through Moses to the people. But the Scripture teaches us that the law, the keeping of the rules, the keeping of the law always leads to death. You can't keep the rules and I can't keep the rules. I'm a rule breaker, not a rule keeper. I desperately needed a grace breakthrough, a different way for me to attain a relationship with God, because all of my best efforts fail miserably when it comes to coming into God's presence. All of your best efforts to contribute to the salvation experience, it fails miserably. We need a grace breakthrough. Repeat this after me. I need a grace breakthrough. Think with me for just a minute. If we're going to go through it, look at your outlines. Number one, first thing we begin to understand about the grace breakthrough is we need to understand the promise of grace. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich." The grace breakthrough tells us this one very important truth, that you and I are rich if we're followers of Jesus Christ. By definition, you and I are rich as followers of Jesus Christ. We are rich in things that money could never buy. We are rich in things that you cannot go out and grab a hold of. We are rich in a deeper relationship with God than ever before. Up to this point, mankind had been trying and working. And Jesus shows up on the scene, and all of a sudden, the grace of God is demonstrated for humanity, demonstrated and shown to humanity through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. God does something for us that none of us could do for ourselves. God did for me what he required of me, so that he could give his life to me and live his life through me. God did for you what he required of you, so that he could give his life to you and live his life through you. There is this grand promise that for those of us who are followers of Christ, we are rich beyond our greatest imagination. We are rich beyond explanation. We are not amazed in the presence of God. We are not amazed in the grace of God. But Scripture teaches us that we should be, because God has given to us everything. Say everything. Everything. He's given to us everything that we need for life through the person of Jesus Christ. Look at the person on your right and the person on your left and tell them, you're sitting next to a rich person right now. Tell them right now. You see, the reality is, I'm not promising you a fat bank account. I'm telling you, you have a bank account that can never be touched. It can never be stolen. It will never go bankrupt. You see, in our bankruptcy, Jesus had to bankrupt himself so that we could become what he was. He became what I am. Spiritually bankrupt so that I could become what he is, spiritually alive. I'm rich beyond imagination. I'm rich beyond my greatest dreams. That's grace. That is the grace of God. There is that promise of the riches of God's grace. Second thing we discover, in order to lay the foundation, we discover there's a problem of grace. There really is. And here's the problem. Satan has blinded us to the truth of grace. He's blinded us to the depth, the breadth, the width, the height. He's blinded us to what grace is really all about. I've given you some verses here, a verse here. Listen to what it says. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3. The problem of grace, if the good news, Paul calls the good news the gospel of grace. If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it's hidden only to people who are perishing. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They're unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this is the message of the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. Here's the problem that we face. We're blinded to what grace really looks like. Here's what I often hear. I often hear people say, it's just too easy. It's just too easy. We live in a culture. This is countercultural. When we talk about the grace of God, it is so countercultural, it's not even funny. I talk to Christians all the time and I ask them, do you know for certain if you're going to go to heaven? And this is the response I get a lot. They go, I hope so. They go, I hope so. And they're hoping so because they think it's somehow tied to their behavior. And I'm here to tell you, the grace of God has nothing to do about your behavior. It has to do with what Jesus has done, not what you do. It has to do with what Jesus has done, not what you do. The problem is we've been blinded to the truth. We don't see clearly the magnitude and the grandeur and the magnificence of God's grace toward us. We don't understand it. We don't get it. We've been blinded to it all. It just doesn't add up. It just doesn't make sense. It's too easy. I hear people say, well, if that guy gets to heaven, I don't want to be there because he's so bad. Now, just imagine. The wickedest, most evil, sinful man in all of Odessa shows up at the Baptist church one Sunday morning. He comes to church. Some of you are going, hey, he's describing me. No, I'm not describing anybody present. So he shows up on Sunday morning. Everybody knows he's a liar. He's a cheat. He's a thief. He's an adulterer. He and his wife are separated. I mean, everything's going on in this poor guy's life. There's even some suspicion that maybe he took somebody else's life. Maybe he killed somebody. They just couldn't prove it. He goes to church one Sunday morning, and he hears the gospel of grace. Here's what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15. He said this. He said, this is the gospel, that Jesus Christ died for our sins and the third day rose according to Scripture. That's it. He sits in the audience and he hears these phrases. He hears this historic statement, Jesus Christ died. If he'd have been there, he realizes, I would have seen that. That man died. Then he hears the theological part. He died for our sins, as the Scripture said. And in that moment, the Lord reveals to him the truth of that passage. Remember, grace and truth came through Jesus. And he becomes a follower of Christ. He doesn't walk forward. He doesn't shake the preacher's hand. He doesn't tell anybody what's happened. But in his heart and in his mind, he has put his faith in what he's just heard. That Jesus Christ died for our sins and the third day rose. He gets on the phone after church and he calls his wife and says, honey, I've made a decision. I need to talk to you. Can I take you out for lunch? And he goes to pick her up, and between I-70, between getting on the interstate and Green Valley, he is run over by a semi and he dies. And every one of us in church that saw him, we're still thinking, that's the wickedest man in all of Odessa. But God sees him differently. God sees him as one of his own. That is the grace of God. It is radical. It is beyond our comprehension, because we always want to confuse salvation with sanctification. We want to believe that it's about our behavior, and it's not. Nothing you can do or fail to do can add to or take away from the grace of God demonstrated on the cross of Calvary. When Jesus shed his blood for you, it was sufficient for all time. And forever. That is the grace of God. But boy, we're blinded to it. We struggle with it. Because I want to measure you through my lens. I want to judge your spiritual life through my lens, instead of through God's grace and goodness. So there is a promise. For those who experience the grace of God, we are rich beyond belief. There is a problem. If Satan wants to defeat the church, all he's got to do is blind us to the truth of grace. Because when he blinds us to that truth, we become judgmental. We become legalistic. We start telling people, you got to follow these rules and those rules. We start trying to add to what Jesus did on the cross. I don't know about you, I need a grace breakthrough. I need a grace breakthrough. Repeat it after me. I need a grace breakthrough. So let's see, who needs a grace breakthrough? Number three, the people who need a grace breakthrough. Number three, the third thing, the people who need a grace breakthrough. So who needs it? We're going to have a refresher course real quickly. See if any of these people feel like you. I got to tell you, I had a lady come out after first service. She came out and she said, every one of those people were me. That's what she said. And I have to be honest. At one time or another, every one of those people were probably me. And I've got news for you. If you're sitting here and you're thinking, I don't need a grace breakthrough, this is for somebody else, I'm here to tell you, need a grace breakthrough. Because the grace breakthrough is for people just like you. So let's see. What kind of people need it? Number one, here it is, whiny people. That's a seminary term that they teach you when you go to seminary and you get all these extra degrees. Whiny people. Whiny people need a grace breakthrough. Whiny people are people that are out of touch with the blessing of God on their life. They're out of touch with the grace of God's blessing. The example that I've given you here is the children of Israel. The children of Israel in the book of Numbers were wandering in the wilderness. And they decided to whine a little bit. After 40 years, you would think that they would have learned that God's grace surrounded them, but they were blinded to it. And so this is what they said. This manna that you give us, our soul loathes it. Why did you bring us out here to die? Why would you do something like this to us? They were whining about everything. And they had no business, because God's grace surrounded them. Oftentimes I'm blinded to the grace of God that surrounds me. When things are not going the way I want it to go, when things are not happening the way I think it should happen, I start looking around saying, where is God in this? Why did God bring me here? Why did God do this to me? What have I done to deserve this? I start asking those kind of questions instead of looking around and seeing the grace of God that surrounded me. They were complaining about the manna. But I got to tell you, it wasn't a culinary issue. It wasn't because it tasted bad. In fact, the book of Psalms, the 75th chapter, says that manna was the food of the angels. It had to be delicious. It was good. This is what it says. Our soul loathes it. It was a spiritual problem. It's the same spiritual problem that sometimes I experience and sometimes you experience when we get so caught up in the moment that we fail to see the grace of God that surrounds us. This morning, I want you to know you are surrounded. No matter what you're going through in life, you are surrounded right now in this moment by the grace of God. Here were people whining about it in the wilderness. And you know what God had done for them? The Bible says this. The Bible says that God had taken care of their shoes so that in 40 years their shoes didn't wear out. And every battle that they got ready to fight, God always fought the battle for them. And God provided them all the food and the nourishment that they needed in the manna. And every time that they got thirsty, He brought the water, even if He had to get it out of a rock. God provided. His grace was abundant. His grace was everywhere. They just didn't see it. How many times do you and I allow the circumstance of our life to blind us to the grace of God? I'm sick. Guess what? I'm not dead. That's a good thing. That is the grace of God. That is the grace of God. God's grace surrounds us. We should see it and claim it and live in it and relish it. What God has done for us through Jesus Christ is a miraculous, wondrous thing, and we should embrace it and love Him because of it. God's grace, who needs it? Whiny people like me need it. Oh my goodness, I can't believe this is going. Whiny people need it. Secondly, B, anxious people need it. People that are out of touch with the protection of God. Anxious people need the grace of God. They need a grace breakthrough. Now listen, when I talk about anxious people here, I'm not talking about a clinical diagnosis of discouragement or anxiety or those kind of things. We're not talking about medical problems here. We're talking about when you and I, who are normal people, when we go beyond just the average worries of life. Every once in a while, we all experience some kinds of worries. But there are some of us that our life is so dominated by worry that it actually impacts our relationships. It actually impacts the way we deal with other people. You know, I could be so worried about, are they going to like this sermon? I'm going to make a fool of myself. What am I going to do? And I could sit down. I could say amen and everybody go home. Y'all go, yay, that's great. But I'm not doing that. Because see, I'm not worried. So Jesus, the example that I give you here, you go back and read the scripture later. Jesus and His disciples, they go down and get in a boat. And He says, hey, let's go across the sea. So they get in the boat and they get in the water. And He goes down and takes a nap. And His disciples start getting worried because a storm comes up. And they go wake Him up. They go wake Him up and say, don't you know, don't you care, don't you even care that we're dying here? You ever felt that way? God, don't you care that I'm dying here? Things are not going the way I want them. Don't you care? And you know, you would think Jesus would go, there, Kevin, it's okay. It's all right, buddy. It's okay. It'll be everything. But He doesn't. You know what Jesus does? He uses a little tough love. He says, you wimp. Where is your faith? Now, that's the Hodges paraphrase, but that's exactly what the Scripture says. Where is your faith? You see, when we are worried and anxious about everything, if you've ever been anxious, you need a grace breakthrough. If you've ever been worried about life, you need a grace breakthrough. Because if Jesus is in your life, you've got all you need. If He's in your boat, you're pretty safe. No. If He's in your boat, you are safe and secure. He was asleep. He wasn't worried about the storm. And what did He do? He took them through the storm. He stood up and said, peace be still. And the storm ended. At least the storm in the physical realm ended. There was still a storm going on. It was in their hearts and in their lives. They needed a grace breakthrough. Because He said, where's your faith? You and I, who are followers of Christ, we claim to believe in Him. We claim to trust Him. Listen, God is not after your effort. He's after your trust. We need a grace breakthrough. We need to realize that if we're whiny people, we need a grace breakthrough. We need to realize if we're an anxious person, we need a grace breakthrough. Repeat it again. I need a grace breakthrough. Third thing. A, B, and C. Number C, judgmental people need a grace breakthrough. Judgmental people. Now, I know I'm looking around the room. None of us would ever judge anybody else. None of us would ever compare our spiritual superiority to anyone else's spiritual inferiority. We would never look at other people and assume anything. You see, people that are judgmental, they have lost touch with the grace of God that brought them up out of the hole. They have forgotten how much God has forgiven them. Jesus tells a parable of a man that owed a lot of money, and the master came to him one day and said, "Hey, you owe this money, you're going to have to pay. If you don't pay, I'm going to throw you in prison." And the man begged him and begged him and begged him, "Don't throw me in prison. I'll make sure that it's all paid." He begged him and begged him, and finally his master said, "Okay, that's fine. I'll forgive it. I'll forgive you of your debt." And immediately the man that was forgiven, he went out and he lost touch. He couldn't remember how much he was forgiven. He went and found someone that owed him money, had him thrown into prison. He was judgmental. He had forgotten. You see, we become judgmental when we start looking at other people and we start thinking that we're somehow spiritually superior to them. Listen, let me tell you something. I don't care who you are. Don't care how long you've been a Christian. You don't own the moral high ground here. Here's the reality. We're all sinners in desperate need of a Savior. Judgmental people, they need a grace breakthrough. People that want to look at others and compare themselves to others and talk about others. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion and released him and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He laid hands on him. He took him by the throat and said, "Pay me what you owe me." Let me tell you, if you're here today and you're a follower of Christ, don't forget, God got you out of a hole. It was a hole you couldn't get out of on your own. Let me make it clear. We were all destined for hell. That's a pretty big hole. And there is no way that I could get myself out. I can't preach enough sermons. I can't give enough money. I can't be moral enough. No. There had to be a grace breakthrough. Jesus Christ had to come and provide a way for me out. He had to come and lift me out. And he did so by going to the cross, by dying for my sins, taking my punishment so that I could be forgiven. We need a grace breakthrough. I need a grace breakthrough. Fourth thing, number four. Let's keep going. The insecure need a grace breakthrough. If I don't like myself, if I can't accept myself, if I'm always beating myself up over every little thing, those insecure people are those that are out of touch with how much we are accepted by God through Jesus Christ. Exodus chapter 4, verses 10 through 12, we find these words. Then Moses, the Lord is calling Moses to be his spokesman to deliver the children of Israel. Moses said, "Lord, I'm not elegant. Since you've spoken to me, your servant, I'm slow of speech, I'm slow of tongue." And the Lord said, "Who's made man's mouth? Or who made the mute, the deaf, the seeing, or the blind? Have not I the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with your mouth, and I will teach you what you should say." I can't emphasize this enough. If you are in Christ Jesus, you are radically accepted by the Father. As long as He is accepted by God, you are accepted by God. Do you hear what I'm telling you? Now here's the problem. We want to measure our life by our spiritual maturity and not by our relationship with Him. If I am in Christ, I am His. I need a grace breakthrough. Because there are times that I beat myself up over things that I do. There are times when I doubt, am I really accepted by the Father? I got to tell you, as a preacher, the devil works on me all the time. He says, if you were really what you should be, you wouldn't be thinking that. You wouldn't be doing that. Anybody else ever had that happen to you? You know what we need? We need a grace breakthrough. We need to recognize that we are fully accepted by our Heavenly Father through Christ Jesus. Listen, I may not like you. That doesn't matter. You're accepted by the Father. The person you're sitting next to may not, well, of course, if that's your spouse, that would be a problem, but they may not like you either, but if you're a follower of Christ, you're accepted by the Father. Are you guys getting this? We live in a world that desperately needs a grace breakthrough. We live in a world that desperately needs to know that there is a way to be accepted by the Father. Listen, people look at you and say, that bunch of hypocrites down at the Baptist church. Let me tell you, I'm a hypocrite, but I'm accepted by my Father. I've had a grace breakthrough. I'm not perfect. And neither are you, those of you that have slipped back over into the judgmental one. Neither are you. We need a grace breakthrough. We all need a grace breakthrough. Say it again. I need a grace breakthrough. It's going to be interesting to see where this all ends up, isn't it? Let's keep going. A couple of more. The overwhelmed people, they need a grace breakthrough. People who need a grace breakthrough. Whiny people, anxious people, judgmental people, insecure people. Have I touched you yet? Overwhelmed people. Overwhelmed people. This is a good one. People that tend to be overwhelmed, they tend to be trying to prove something or punish something or perform in a way that makes them acceptable. Mary and Martha is a great contrast to that. But Martha was distracted with much serving. She was doing stuff. And she approached Jesus and said, Lord, don't you care that my sister's left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. She was overwhelmed. Jesus answered and said, Martha, Martha, you're worried and troubled about many things. Only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is good and it won't be taken from her. Mary slipped over into legalistic works. Started judging her sister. Man, I know none of us are ever guilty of that. Stepping over into our good works and starting to look around and judge other people and say, well, that person's not any good. That person can't do it. That person can't be that person. That's not a good Christian. And then we get overwhelmed. We don't know where to turn because we're so busy doing stuff. Listen, you can do a lot of good stuff. You can be successful at a lot of good stuff. But if you have no relationship with Jesus Christ, you need a grace breakthrough. You can be successful at the things of the world and not be successful with God. Martha was busy and she was doing all good stuff. But guess what? Jesus said what Mary had chosen was the best thing. What has she chosen? To spend time with Him. That's grace. See, we're talking something really radical here because the reality is I want to measure everybody else by where I'm at. Instead of recognizing the grace that God had demonstrated toward me and then extending that grace toward you. I can't judge you. I can't stand in God's place. That's His position. What I can do is extend grace. What I can do is live in grace. What I can do is release this sense of being overwhelmed. I can stop trying so hard. God is not after my effort. He's after my trust. Boy, I can't believe the Baptist preacher just said that. Aren't we supposed to pick ourselves up and to clean ourselves off and to live the Christian life and keep all the Ten Commandments and all the rules? I'm so glad that the gospel is so much simpler than all that because I don't know everything. Here's the gospel. Christ died for our sins according to Scripture and was buried and the third day rose as Scripture has said. That's the gospel. That's what I got to get in order to have a grace breakthrough. Now listen, there's other stuff to come, but we're talking about the grace breakthrough. We're not talking about a disciple's life. We're talking about a grace breakthrough. We're not talking about growing into spiritual maturity. We're talking about a grace breakthrough. There's a difference. We're not talking about sanctification, that process whereby we push sin out of the way. We're talking about salvation. We're talking about an understanding that sometimes even those of us who are saved, we fall back into legalism and works and judgmentalism and anxiety. And what we need is a grace breakthrough. Huh. You guys are getting awfully quiet. Are you asleep yet? Overwhelmed people. Now, let me run through them again for you real quick, so make sure you got them on your blanks. Whiny people, anxious people, judgmental people, insecure people, overwhelmed people. There's one more. Because some of you may be sitting there going, boy, he's hit everybody in the church but me. Here's the last group. Smug people. Smug people. You know, the interesting thing was Jesus had an encounter with his disciples and his Pharisees, and he told them, he said, you know, if you follow me, you'll be free indeed. And their first response was, wait a minute, we're the children of Abraham. We've never been enslaved to anyone. We're always free. And he said, he that sins is a slave to sin. He said, you've got a river flowing from the Temple Mount that's filled with blood because you keep trying to atone for your own sinfulness. So that makes you a slave. But I've come to declare a different kind of gospel to you. I've come to declare a gospel of grace, which says, I'm going to do something here that's going to transform all this and set you free from sin. That's the gospel of grace. That's the gospel of grace. And all of us need this gospel of grace, these smug people. Notice what I've given here, John 8, 31 through 36. Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my words, you're my disciples indeed. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And they answered him, we're Abraham's descendants. We've never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say you'll make us free? Jesus answered them, most assuredly I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. Most assuredly, and a slave doesn't abide in his father's house forever, but the son abides forever. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I need a grace breakthrough. Because I may not be that judgmental person and I may not be that anxious person, but sometimes I get that smug feeling. How about you? Sometimes I start thinking, well, if they were just all as spiritual as me, they'd be all right. No. If they were as spiritual as you, they wouldn't be all right. If they were as spiritual as me, they wouldn't be all right. What we need is a grace breakthrough. What we need is a recognition that we need something to break through to set us free from the sin that condemns us. And that's what Jesus came to do. He came to break through for people like you and for people like me. He came to provide a grace breakthrough for all of us if we can just see it, if we can just embrace it. Whiny people, yep. Hurting people, yep. People like me, yep. People like you. So how do we begin the journey? Again, we're laying foundation work here. I'm trying to whet your appetite so that you know that the next several weeks, God willing, we're going to be dealing with this grace breakthrough. We're going to learn what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross. We're going to learn what he's done so that we will stand amazed at the grace of God. How do you start the journey? First, I must admit that I need a grace breakthrough. Here's what Scripture says. I'm a sinner, you're a sinner. And there's nothing I can do to clean my life up. There's nothing I can do to eliminate the stain of sin on my life. I have to admit that I need a grace breakthrough. Secondly, I've got to believe that Jesus provided a grace breakthrough. That Jesus went to the cross of Calvary and died, taking the punishment for my sin and for yours. He died on the cross. He was buried and on the third day rose in victory so that he could affirm that my sins had been forgiven, that his sacrifice had been accepted by the Father, and that now I could walk into the grace of God and live a new life in relationship with him. I've got to believe that Jesus Christ is the way. Listen, there is no plan B. When you stand before the Father and He says, why should I let you in? If you've got any other reason, any other thing that you're going to tell Him besides through Jesus Christ and His blood alone, then you're not making it. I'm just being honest. Because we need a grace breakthrough. But I'm a good person. I'm sorry. It's about Jesus. Grace is about Jesus. I've got to believe that He provided the way for my grace breakthrough. And then lastly, once I've admitted, once I believe, then I can commit myself to walk with Him in grace. Not before. Guess what? Dead people don't follow anybody. And this is what Scripture says. Before Christ, I am dead in my sins and trespasses. I can't be committed to Him until I admit to my need, until I believe that He died for me. I don't know about you. I need a grace breakthrough. Repeat it after me. I need a grace breakthrough. Let's bow together. Father, thank you.